بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الموضوع اللي احنا هنتكلم عليه النهارده دايابيتس ميليتس. دايابيتس ميليتس it is the most important topic in endocrinology. دايابيتس ميليتس will be presented in four parts. And this is the lecture outline which will be divided into four parts. We'll speak first about the introduction, physiology and pathophysiology, classification and diagnosis, and how to evaluate a diabetic patient. And then we'll speak in some details about type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, and then we will speak about hypoglycemia. And finally, we will end this four series, or this series, which will be in four parts, by speaking about the chronic complications of diabetes. Introduction. It is very important that in every single disease that we explain, that you understand the basic definition. What is diabetes mellitus? Diabetes mellitus, it is a group of metabolic disorders characterized by hyperglycemia. And that's why most of the current guidelines, when they address diabetes, they address it as a hyperglycemic disorder. So diabetes, it is characterized by hyperglycemia, and it is the result of two main things. Number one, problem in the insulin secretion, or problem in the insulin action, or both. So this is the definition of diabetes mellitus. I already mentioned that diabetes mellitus, it is the most important topic in endocrinology. Why I am saying this? Let's have a look on the what is called the global diabetes epidemic, or the global burden of diabetes. This diagram actually, it represents the number of diabetic patients distributed in the world. And let's have a look here on the region of the Middle East and North Africa. By the year 2019, and the number of diabetic patients were 55 million, expected to reach 76 million by the year 2030, expected to reach 108 million by the year 2045. So we are having a truly what we can describe as the diabetes epidemic. The same thing actually applies for the rest of the regions, but we will focus here in the region of the Middle East and North Africa. And this diagram, it represents the approximate number of diabetic patients in millions distributed all over the world. Notice here that the areas which are actually having the color of dark red, they possess the highest number of patients with diabetes. Here in our country in Egypt, actually the number of cases is around 10 million population with diabetes. And let's have a look here in the region of the Middle East. This diagram, it doesn't represent the absolute number, but it represents the prevalence. Now, notice that the highest areas with the highest prevalence of diabetes, it is in Egypt, Libya, Sudan, most of the Gulf countries. And actually the prevalence here, it is estimated more than 9%. And when we speak about the expected prevalence of diabetes, in the year 2019, the global prevalence was about 9%. It is expected to reach almost 11% by the year 2045. And a similar condition, which we'll speak about in more details, which is called impaired glucose tolerance. Again, it is estimated that it has a prevalence of 7.5, expected to reach almost 9% by the year 2045. Let's have a look here on the situation in Egypt. Regarding the prevalence of diabetes in Egypt, Egypt actually is included among the top 10 countries with the highest prevalence in diabetes. Now, in the year 2019, Egypt was ranking number 9. It is expected to be ranking number 8 by the year 2030, and it will reach into the 7th ranking by the year 2045, which means every single year, there are more additional cases of diabetes. And that's why it is a very important topic, in the sense, none of you, you will avoid confrontation with a case of diabetes, because actually you will have any of your friends or relatives or family members, but for sure, by all means, there will be some sort of a diabetic patient among your family members or your friends or your close relatives. And this table actually, it represents the association of diabetes with some morbidities related to different systems. So actually we can see here that there is a very strong association of diabetes with other cardiovascular disease, and there is an increased risk of coronary and ischemic heart disease, cerebrovascular stroke, and even death. And they are all related intimately to the presence of diabetes mellitus. And those various figures, actually, they represent the results obtained from different studies conducted in different areas of the world. So to translate this into a statement, actually, diabetes, it is the fourth most common reason for the contact of a patient to an American physician. Diabetes, it is the number one leading cause of blindness and end-stage renal disease and non-traumatic limb amputations, because these are the important chronic complications of diabetes. Also, diabetes, it is highly associated with risks of the cardiovascular and cerebral and peripheral vascular disease. And in a separate slide, we will remember the concept of the risk factors in which diabetes is a prominent cause. And as we mentioned, diabetes, actually, it is included in the top 10 ranking countries regarding the prevalence of diabetes. And it is estimated that almost 9 million people are actually diabetic. And this statistics was obtained by the year 2019. And this figure actually presents the summation of type 1 and type 2. And it is expected to reach 17 million patients by the year of 2045. The overall prevalence of diabetes in Egypt, including type 1 and type 2, it's almost 11.5 or 12% in some figures. Now let's proceed into the basic physiology and pathophysiology. Now, diabetes, it is related to defective insulin production or insulin secretion. Insulin is produced by the pancreas. And if we look at the pancreas, we can look at it. It is composed of an endocrine part and exocrine part. The exocrine part, it represents 80%. The endocrine part actually represents 20%, or the islets of Langerhans. And we have three different types of cells in the islets of Langerhans. The alpha cells produce glucagon, the beta cells produce insulin, the delta cells produce somatostatin. Now, what are the various factors which are responsible for increasing or decreasing insulin production? The most important stimuli which will increase the insulin production is the glucose, amino acids, acetylcholine, and some medications like sulfonylureas. On the other hand, the production of insulin is suppressed by somatostatin, beta blockers, and thiazide diuretics. The insulin secretion actually inside the endocrine cell of the pancreas, it starts by the entry of glucose into the cell. And usually this is accompanied by entry of calcium. And this actually, this combination, entry of calcium and glucose, will result in an activation of a process resulting in the release of the insulin by a process of exocytosis of the vesicles which contain the preformed insulin. The process of insulin secretion in a normal person occurs in two stages. The initial stage, which actually occurs immediately after meals, it is actually representing the stage of the release of the preformed insulin stored inside the vesicles inside the pancreatic cells. But after you continue to eat and continuation of elevation of blood glucose, there is another process, which is the de novo synthesis and new synthesis amounts of insulin by the beta cells. So the initial phase, it is the immediate release by the preformed stored insulin. And then the second phase, it is characterized by production of insulin, which will produce by de novo synthesis. And this diagram represents what I'm talking about. The initial stage, a very quick stage, because actually we need to produce insulin after meals in order to get a very quick control of the blood glucose, which occurs after meals. This initial stage, it is related to the release of the preformed insulin. The second stage, more or less, it's a sustained stage in which there is a de novo synthesis of the insulin. Now, let's again revise together. What are the various effects of insulin? Number one, the target organs or the target tissues on which the insulin produces its effects are the adipose tissue, the liver, and the muscles. The effects of insulin on the adipose tissue, it enhances utilization of glucose. It enhances the fatty acid synthesis. It enhances triglyceride synthesis. And most important, it inhibits lipolysis of the triglycerides. Triglycerides are composed of glycerol and fatty acids. When they are hydrolyzed, this will release fatty acid. So insulin, it prevents or decreases the activity of hormone, which increases the lipolysis of the triglycerides. Effect of insulin on the liver, it increases the utilization of glucose, increases the process of glycogen synthesis, which is glycogenesis, increases the protein synthesis, increases the lipid synthesis, and the effect finally of the insulin on the muscles, it also enhances the uptake of insulin, of glucose, and increases the glycogen synthesis and decreases the protein catabolism. Now, there's also another table which actually looks at the effects of insulin from another perspective. Overall effects on the carbohydrate metabolism. Insulin actually, it increases the utilization of glucose, which is glycolysis. It increases actually the process of glycogen synthesis, and it inhibits the process of synthesizing of glucose from non-carbohydrate source, which is gluconeogenesis. So remember, insulin, it stimulates glycogenesis, which is glycogen synthesis, and it suppresses gluconeogenesis, which is the synthesis of glucose from non-carbohydrate source. And insulin increases the protein synthesis, and at the very same time, the process of protein breakdown, this is inhibited by insulin. On the lipid or adipose tissue, insulin enhances the triglyceride synthesis and enhances the process of lipogenesis, and insulin, it suppresses the process of breaking down triglycerides, or actually it inhibits the lipolysis. Now let's talk about what are the various factors affecting blood glucose level. When you are fasting, your blood glucose level, it is dependent on how much does the liver produce glucose and what is the sensitivity of your liver to your fasting level of insulin. Now, what are the factors which are responsible for the postprandial glucose? Postprandial, it means after meals. The factors which are responsible for the level of glucose after meals, number one, the level of the glucose before you eat, which is the preprandial glucose, and it is dependent on the glucose load from meals expected, how much glucose you supply your bowel. And it is also dependent of how much insulin you secrete and what is the status of the peripheral tissues to the insulin, which is called insulin sensitivity of the peripheral tissues. Generally speaking, the hyperglycemia in diabetes, as we mentioned, it is caused by insulin deficiency. Simultaneous with it, there will be increase in glucagon production, and this will result in increase in the process of gluconeogenesis by the liver. What is gluconeogenesis? It is the synthesis of glucose from non-carbohydrate source. Again, this diagram, it represents the overall factors responsible for hyperglycemia, in which there is a deficiency of insulin secretion, increased glucose output by the liver by gluconeogenesis, and decrease in the peripheral utilization of the tissues for glucose. And again, this is the diagram which represents the consequences of insulin deficiency, all of which will be contributing to hyperglycemia. Now, we move into the topic of the classification and diagnosis. Diabetes mellitus is classified into type 1, type 2, gestational diabetes, and specific types of diabetes. Now, type 1 diabetes, it is a diabetes caused by an immune-mediated beta cell destruction. Type 2 diabetes, it is caused by a progressive loss of the beta cell stimulating secretion, which is the beta cells, resulting in insulin deficiency. And usually the process of type 2 diabetes starts by insulin resistance, and we shall speak about it in details later on. The third type, which is gestational diabetes, which is diabetes diagnosed during pregnancy for the first time, usually in the second or the third trimester of pregnancy. And finally, a specific types of diabetes includes many, many causes. And one of them is an entity which is called monogenic diabetes syndromes. What about type 1 diabetes? Type 1 diabetes, it represents a small proportion of cases of diabetes. It is only responsible for less than 10% of the overall cases of diabetes. The hallmark of type 1 diabetes is cell-mediated autoimmune destruction of the pancreatic beta cells. Usually, the type 1 diabetes, it represents at a young age. However, this is not an absolute rule, because sometimes we see cases of type 1 diabetes presenting even after the age of 40. Because in this condition, the autoimmune process is slow and it takes time. And this type of diabetes, which is type 1, which can present in old age, we call it LADA, late onset autoimmune diabetes. Now, in type 1 diabetes, insulin or exogenous insulin supplementation is a necessity for the treatment. Why? Because it is important to supply exogenous insulin to control the blood glucose and to prevent diabetic ketoacidosis and to preserve life. So type 1 diabetes, there are no alternatives from treating the patient with insulin. Type 2 diabetes, it accounts for more than 90%. And the initial mechanism responsible for type 2 diabetes, it is insulin resistance. Usually it is seen in the adult life. However, now it is frequently encountered that we have type 2 diabetes in children because of the bad dietary habits and the increased prevalence of overweight and obesity, subsequently insulin resistance in the young age. So actually we see now many cases of type 2 diabetes diagnosed during childhood. Now remember, type 2 diabetes, it is very frequently to be associated with obesity, family history of diabetes, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, and ischemic heart disease. The third entity, which is gestational diabetes, it is diabetes which is diagnosed for the first time during pregnancy, which is usually during the second or third trimester because of the action of the placental hormones, estrogen, and progesterone. Now, the importance of gestational diabetes, some of the cases after delivery, the blood glucose level returns back to normal. However, it is estimated that about 60% of females diagnosed as gestational diabetes will develop a frank type 2 diabetes within 5 years. And the importance of this piece of information that every single female diagnosed as gestational diabetes should be put under strict follow-up at least for 5 years to make sure that she will not turn into a frank case of type 2 diabetes. The specific types of diabetes, sometimes some of the entities we call it secondary diabetes, for example, disorders of the exocrine pancreas, chronic pancreatitis, acromegaly, Cushing syndrome, all these can cause diabetes. Sometimes you get diabetes secondary to effect of drugs like steroids. Now, a specific entity of the specific types of diabetes, an entity which is called monogenic diabetes syndromes. Monogenic diabetes syndromes, what are monogenic diabetes syndrome? This is a separate entity of diabetes, which results from a mutation of a specific gene resulting in this entity, which is called monogenic. One of the famous types of monogenic diabetes is an entity which is called MODY. MODY is the abbreviation for maturity onset diabetes of youth. And it was previously categorized as a subtype of type 2 diabetes, but now it is a separate entity. So maturity onset diabetes of youth is one form of monogenic diabetes, which is classified as a separate entity, which is the monogenic diabetes syndromes. Monogenic diabetes syndrome, it can result from genetic mutation in many, many locations, which can reach up to 13 locations. So this means that we have many, many types of MODY, which is one of the monogenic types of diabetes, but actually the commonest of these subtypes is the MODY type 3. Now, the maturity onset diabetes of youth, it is characterized that hyperglycemia, it occurs at a very early stage. That is why it is frequently misdiagnosed as type 1. And usually MODY is characterized by a genetic mutation. This genetic mutation, it will result in impairment in the insulin secretion rather than immune-mediated destruction of the pancreatic beta cells like this, which occurs in type 1 diabetes. Usually those patients are non-obese. And one of the characteristic features of the MODY is that the degree of hyperglycemia is not severe. It is not high, in contrary to the level of the blood glucose, which is encountered in type 1 diabetes. And usually they have a very strong family history. This is very important. A strong family history in a young age and the blood glucose, it's not so much high. Always consider that this can be monogenic diabetes mellitus because some forms of the monogenic diabetes can actually respond to sulfonylureas. And again, the importance of recognizing this type is that usually the presentation is atypical and it is very often misdiagnosed as type 1 diabetes. So in those cases which are moody or monogenic, the treatment actually, sometimes we can use sulfonylureas, which have no place in treatment of type 1 diabetes mellitus. Now we come for the diagnostic criteria. This is very important. What are the diagnostic criteria of diabetes? The diagnostic criteria of diabetes, number one, glycosylated hemoglobin more than or equal 6.5, symptomatic patient with a random blood sugar more than 200, and fasting blood glucose more than or equals 126, or 2 hours postprandial more than 200. These are the diagnostic criteria for diabetes mellitus. It was found that there is an entity of patients who actually do not fulfill the criteria of diabetes mellitus. At the very same time, the blood glucose level is a little bit high to be considered as normal. So we collectively apply the term pre-diabetes for these cases. Or actually, if we imagine that a normal person is having a white color, diabetic person is having a black color. In other words, if you draw three colors on the ground, one is white, the other is gray, the third is black. Imagine that the diabetic patient actually is standing inside the black box. A normal person is standing inside the white box. In between, which is the gray box, this is the pre-diabetes. Now, the entities of pre-diabetes, again, they do not fulfill the full-blown picture of diabetes. However, the blood glucose level are a little bit high to be considered normal. And it is important to recognize this entity, because patients with pre-diabetes, if properly managed, actually the blood glucose can revert back to normal. And the pre-diabetics are also prone to increased risk of ischemic heart disease and other cardiovascular complications. Now, what are the criteria for pre-diabetes? The criteria for pre-diabetes, if the fasting in between, or actually more than 100 and less than 125, we call this the impaired fasting. And if the 2 hour postprandial is between 140 and 199, we call this impaired glucose tolerance, or A1C, it is more than 5.7, but less than 6.4. These criteria fulfill the diagnosis of a pre-diabetes. So let's have a look on this table. In a normal person, the normal levels of the blood glucose, a normal person should have A1C less than 5.7, should have fasting less than 100, should have 2 hour postprandial less than 140. Pre-diabetes, the range is between 5.7 to 6.4, and it is more than 125. Remember, because this patient, if he reaches the level of 126, this is no longer pre-diabetes, it is frank diabetes. And the impaired glucose tolerance, it is a level more than 140 and less than 200. Remember, if the postprandial level exceeds 200, it is no longer pre-diabetes and it is diabetes. So this is the complete table, which represents the normal levels, the pre-diabetes and the diabetes. You have to remember all these figures, because this table, it's one of the very important tables related to the diagnosis of diabetes. A very quick reminder, because an intimately related factor to diabetes and pre-diabetes is the concept of risk factors. Remember that the risk factors, which was already explained in cardiovascular diseases, it includes the major risk factors, which are smoking, hyperlipidemia, and hypertension. These are the major risk factors. The rest of the risk factors are shown here in the table. Remember that those risk factors, if they are present, it means that this patient will be liable to develop the catastrophic cardiovascular complications, which are cerebrovascular stroke, ischemic heart disease, and peripheral heart disease. An intimately related topic to the risk factor is the metabolic syndrome. A metabolic syndrome is a syndrome which is characterized by abdominal obesity, insulin resistance, hyperglycemia, hypertension, elevated level of triglycerides, and elevated level of low-density lipoproteins. And these are the diagnostic criteria of the metabolic syndrome. And always remember, there is an intimate relationship between the risk factors in cardiovascular disease and the pre-diabetes and complications of both. And remember, the risk factors which includes diabetes among them, it is the risk factors which will result in the development of the catastrophic cardiovascular events, which are cerebrovascular stroke, ischemic heart disease, and peripheral vascular disease. This is a nice table which represents that if you are able to discover the patient with pre-diabetes, you are actually able, you will be able to revert his blood glucose level to normal. Because once the patient fulfills the diagnostic criteria of diabetes, there is no going back, and all what you can do for him will be actually controlling his blood glucose level with either insulin or drugs. And we shall discuss the treatment of diabetes mellitus in part 3 and part 4. This actually concludes the part 1. And in the next part, we shall speak in more details about type 1 diabetes and type 2 diabetes. Thank you.